Welcome to Command Control Power, a weekly podcast hosted by three certified members of the Apple Consultants Network, drawing from nearly half a century of combined experience. We talk shop, interview vendors and colleagues, and share what we've learned while operating our technology consulting practices. This is Joe Saponari of CIMAC, and my two co-hosts are Jerry Zygmunt of MacWorks and Sam Valencia of the HCS Technology Group. We also offer a weekly email newsletter, which includes show notes for each episode. Learn more at commandcontrolpower.com. And thanks for listening. This episode of Command Control Power is brought to you commercial-free and is made possible by our Patreon sponsors. You can help bring more commercial-free episodes by going to patreon.com/cmdctrlpwr and supporting the show with a monthly pledge. Thank you for your support of Command Control Power. Thanks very much to our VIP supporters whose generous support earns them a special place at the top of the show. Alan Hancock, watchmanmonitoring.com/ccp. Taylor Boyko, simplemdm.com, and John Brown, grovetech.co. And special thanks to Jason Detbarn of adagy.com and Adam Angst of Tidbits Content Network, tcn.tidbits.com. Thank you all very much for your support.
So I've had a story that I wanted to share with you guys for a couple of months now, and we've had some other important issues to talk about and things that we need to sort of get out there. And so this was one of those evergreen kind of things that I could bring up just about any time. So I decided tonight was the perfect night to do it. I got a phone call out of the blue a couple months back by a family that said that we have a Mac SE. We were wondering if you could get the information off of this Mac SE. Now, my first Mac was not a Mac SE, for sure. It was either a Quadra 650, I think a Quadra 650 was my first Mac, and that came much later. So this particular Mac SE, I think, was using OS version 6. I told the person, you came to the right spot. I mean, you could probably spend all day on the phone trying to call people to see if they could do this, but, you know, this would be a project I would certainly like to undertake. I don't really have the necessary equipment. I said, but I'm sure we can figure it out. If the drive spins up and the Mac SE starts to work in some sort of fashion, we should be able to harvest the data off. And if not, you know, I could try to remove the drive and then we could see what we could do from there if the actual Mac SE wasn't operational. So I met them in a parking lot up where my daughter goes to school. You know, this elderly woman came up and she had everything in a box. And she said, I'm not sure if this is something that I think it's really important for it. And what it was a separately boxed Twiggy drive. That was the code name, the build name that Apple used to have for the 3.5-inch, they called them floppies, but they really weren't floppies, because it was named after the model Twiggy, who was ultra thin, and she would pose in mini skirts, and it was the big sensation in the 1960s. So they called it the Twiggy drive because this thing was so thin. And I said, well, you know, that might be able to help us, but I said, we're going to probably use this other port. And I pointed to the SCSI that was on the back of this Mac SE. And so I brought it back, and miraculously, the thing powered right up. It spun up, and they had a keyboard, and they had an ADB mouse that plugged into the keyboard, and I was able to see the data on the drive. Now, this Mac, I think when it was new, cost approximately $3,698, and I think that was back right around 1983. And if you adjust for inflation and you're sort of modest in calculating what that might be worth in 2021 or what kind of dollars that was, it's probably double. So somewhere around $7,800. And one of the most amazing things I found in, like, just looking at this SE and not having seen one for such a long time or operated one was how little you could do on it. There was a Mac draw program, but you could do these really crude, rudimental drawings. It was a monochrome screen. There were no images to speak of. There was no internet. There was no email. It was just basically Word documents. And if you think about it, it's just a real hard thing to wrap your head around why people would have paid that much money back in the day just for typing.
Right.
You know?
It's such a good point. Yeah, these days we think like the internet is just step zero. I mean, all the output you might have on a daily basis is either going to go to email, go to Dropbox, you know, some kind of cloud service. It's going to be like posted on a website. the output is all digital now. But back then, it was really impressive to be able to like just print out a piece of paper that had like multiple fonts on it. You know, I remember I turned in my Spanish homework in like, you know, second grade or something, and it was printed out from my Performa or whatever I think my first Mac was. And, you know, because I could make the little like tilde character over the N, I mean, stop me if I've shared the story five times already, but it was really impressive back then. Like the teacher was just like, how did you do that? You know, it was like I was handing her like a polished, you know, Spanish language book or something. I just, cause like you could do it at home. It was really impressive back then.
Yeah, on a dot matrix computer. I mean, because no one had the money for a laser printer.
No, well, I mean, later on, I had a StyleWriter. So that was the other thing Apple did was, wow, you know, they started selling, you know, and the StyleWriter wasn't even super expensive. It wasn't laser. It was like one of the first, you know, kind of commodity like inkjets, you know. And this was back in the day, you know, people complain Apple doesn't make wireless routers anymore. They used to make printers. And the StyleWriter was 300 DPI, I think it was, if I'm just going from memory. You know, so it wasn't dot matrix. It was like a step above that even. And I mean, but yeah, you're talking back in the day when you had the image writer probably with the little like, you know, like printing on, felt like it was engraving the paper with your print. I mean, it was literally like using little pins to, you know, smash the ink onto the paper.
Right, right. So I started to look online about how to get this data, this minimal amount of data that they had off of this Mac. I couldn't find anything, nothing substantial. Again, it had a SCSI port on the back, but I had nothing to connect that to. And I know there's some guys on Slack who do have machines that still take a SCSI port. You know, one of them is Dave Provine, who's also been very helpful in the past with some other projects I've had. But then I would have had to send him this. It just seemed like a real hurdle. So I was thinking, well, is there any way I could do this locally? So I'm searching and searching. And then I come across this website called BigMessOWires.com. There's this guy from California who evidently had an itch that he needed to scratch, and he made a floppy emulator called the Floppy Emu. And it's basically a hard disk emulator for either a classic Apple II, a Macintosh, which is what I had, and also Lisa. And you use a tiny little SD card that you insert in this floppy emulator, and you plug it into the SCSI port. Magically, it'll mount as a hard drive, and then you can take the data and drag it off of the internal drive and put it on this SD card, because again, it's mimicking an Apple floppy disk. And so it behaves just like a real hard drive. And I forget exactly what the pricing was, but I also needed that the mouse was a little dodgy. So the ADB mouse that they gave me. So additionally, what this person sold from BigMessOWires.com was an ADB to USB and a USB to ADB converter, so I could take a regular USB mouse and jack it into the ADB port. So problem solved there, right? So then I was able to copy all this data onto this SD drive. Well, ironically, you couldn't take the SD card and plug it in with a reader into your Mac and have the Mac recognize it, which I thought was the most ironic thing in the world. The current Mac operating system would not be able to read this data at all. So what I needed to do was I needed to fire up my Parallels copy of Windows 10, and then there were a couple of free open source programs. One was called a2ciderpress.com, and what that does is it allows you to read the data that I copied onto this micro SD card, which I thought was amazing. It's basically a Windows utility for managing Apple II file archives and disk images. So that was great. So in my copy of Windows 10 running on Parallels on my modern Mac, I downloaded this A2CiderPress reader, and I could see the information from these Word files. But I couldn't convert it to DOCX. And that was my problem, is that I could see the data, but it wasn't maintaining the formatting or even doing font substitutions. You know, garbage headers and garbage footers, but the text was readable. You know, that was a win, but I was going to see if I could go one step better. And I found online this website called Convertio.co, and it magically took these old Word files, and I think they were Word 5.0 files, and converted them to DOCX files. And when I opened them up, in my modern version of Word, all the formatting was retained. It was amazing. It was just like totally amazing. And that was free too. And it's a file converter. So it's called Convertio, easy tool to convert files online, more than 309 different document images, spreadsheets, ebooks, and archives and formats that it will deal with. Totally amazing. So I uploaded all this data to Dropbox and was able to save it out immediately to the client. And then I was able to put them on USB keys. They asked for a couple USB keys formatted for Mac, modern day Mac, and then a couple formatted for Windows. Happy to do that for them. And then I met up with them.
In another
sketchy parking lot. And the upshot of that was that they ended up giving me the Mac SE, which is now in my basement. And I really didn't charge them anything for this, other than the cost of getting the emulator and the ADB to USB converter. So it was probably less than $200, and they were tickled to death.
That's fine, Jerry. You'll make up for it in volume, as the saying goes. I was sitting here waiting to quip at some point. You know, let me guess, what did you charge them? 30 minutes, you know, because we have this, Sam and I have this intervention sometimes on the show to tell Jerry to charge more for the work you do. And you're telling us you didn't charge anything. I mean,
hey, you
explain yourself. Explain yourself. Come on. You can't pay your bills with the free, Mac 2 SE or whatever.
All right. You've drawn it out of me. So this Mac is almost, 20 years old, right? And it had writings on it from a daughter that they had who was in high school. She passed away because she had cancer. This was the first time in all these years that they wanted to preserve whatever was on there and save a little bit of her memory. So,
wow. Yeah. Wow. That's beautiful, man. I'm humbled. I'll never make another joke again.
How dare you, Joe?
I can't promise I'll never make another joke again, but I would probably do the same thing in that situation. In fact, I went through something like that recently where a client of mine, long, long time client of mine, was lost her husband almost a year ago. And this time last year was around the time when he started to decline. So Apple's photo widget on the iPhone was suggesting lots of memories from last year that were not very nice memories for my client and friend. So she kind of called me, in her terms, freaking out. I mean, she was pretty devastated to see some of these photos popping up and the phone like suggesting these photos like almost forcibly. So I actually remoted into her Mac. Everything's turned on with iCloud Photo Library, of course. So I went into her Mac and I went through the photo library. You know, this was something we agreed to. Obviously, I offered to do this for her. And hid all the photos that may be a trigger. You know, basically she said hide all the photos of her husband from, like June 1st until August. That's what I did. And of course I didn't charge her for it. I mean, it was just clearly the right thing to do. And furthermore, I didn't want to send an invoice that referred to this project, you know, which opens up another wound. So yeah, I totally get that, man. That's okay. That's the one exception I will accept for you not charging for something, Jerry.
Well, I must admit, I did tell you that I did charge them for the hardware. So I didn't charge them for any labor. And just to give you an idea, if you're listening to this and you go like, oh my gosh, I've been looking for this for the ages. It's very, very reasonable. We'll put the link in the show notes, but the floppy emu with the case, floppy emu is $119 and then the case is $17, this little plastic case that wraps around it. And then the ADB to USB converter, which he calls the Wombat, was $49. And including shipping, I think the whole thing came to $179. And they were brought to tears by all this, the flood of memories that all these writings brought back for them. A better man wouldn't have charged them for the hardware, but...
I think recovering the cost of the hardware is reasonable. I mean, you didn't charge for your time, which is very respectful. And... you know, I'm actually, you know, quite impressed with the whole process that you took, just that there was a lot of different conversion processes and hardware that it took to get through that. And I mean, that takes a lot of patience as well and some diligence. So good on you for that. You were talking about the Convertio product. It reminded me of MacLink Plus back in the day. That was like a really handy tool back then that I used to use a lot.
Sure. Well, you know, so Sam, thank you for saying that. But in the back of my mind, I was thinking, what would Joe do? You know what I mean?
Of course, we're all saying that.
Because Joe has these great stories where he regales us with these heroic efforts, and he always wins. You know, he always gets to the data. He makes the client happy. So, Joe, you inspired me to dig deep.
Well, thanks. I'm honored. What a reputation. That's thank you for saying that. And I do have some tenacity that sometimes bites me because sometimes, you know, causes me to suffer from the sunk cost fallacy for way too long. Sometimes perseverance pays off. So that's clearly a story of that, Jerry. That's a heroic level of effort to go through. I mean, you had to go through Windows at one point. I mean, you can make an action movie about it. It's pretty extreme.
I love the way you talk about the fact that he had to go through Windows as being like an awful traumatic experience.
Yeah. Exactly. I'm thinking of Tom Cruise, like with lasers and you know, rappelling down a building, inside a building or something like that, you know, and having like a blue screen of death, you know, and that's what he's like facing.
But isn't that ironic that there's an open source utility that only runs on Windows for managing Apple archives? Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
So switching gears here for a moment, this goes under the category of, I shouldn't have known this, but go figure. I'm the poor guy here on the show who's still running the old Mac from 2015, and there's a lot of crazy things that happen to it. And most of them, as we know as technicians, we kind of tolerate. Oh yeah, it's doing that thing, and you just sort of wait for it to pass or whatever. But there was this thing that was driving the heck out of me. I love a text expander. It's part of my workflow all the time. I've got a number of snippets that I like to expand. One's for invoicing, one's for replying to clients with repetitive questions and things like that. And one of the things that's been happening to me, and of course I've got the current version of text expander where it's online. So theoretically, if you sign out of the app, your snippets go away and then you have to sign in and it loads them all in. So I went to type in some snippets and sometimes they expand out instantaneously and you hear that little pop. I would imagine you could change the noise. And other times it sits there and doesn't do anything. And sometimes I'm like, oh heck. And I go back to something else and all of a sudden it does the snippet expansion right on whatever window I've opened up. And I'm like, ah, you know, kind of thing. Man, it's just like stupid connectivity with my computer. Like, this is driving me crazy, you know? So one day, I just threw up my hands. I said, this is enough. So I opened up a support ticket with the folks over at Smile. And I said, you know, this is really crazy, but this happens on my computer. And within a day, they responded back, and what do you think they said?
Get a new computer?
They said, yes. Be like Joe and Sam and buy an M1. Nice. Money be damned. No, they actually said, this has been a reported problem among some of our users, and this is not a fix, but it's a workaround that if you go into mission control mode for 1 second and then flip back, magically, the snippet will, they didn't use the word magically, I'm using the word magically. Magically, the snippet will expand. So it actually works. So when it stalls and it's just like sitting there and it's not spinning or anything, it's just like nothing happens. And it doesn't record the last character either. So like if my snippet is TXTS or something like that, I see TXT, but it never reads the S, because it's trying to just state the X or S or something like that. But then if I flip up with mission control, go back and it like boop, and it expands. So if you're out there, you can thank me if this is a problem that you've been having. And again, it's not a solution, but it's a workaround. But it's interesting that I felt vindicated in a way, like, oh, it's not my janky old computer.
I wonder who figured that out.
I know. Like, I know.
Someone mistakenly swiped up and like, oh, wait a second. And they found a consistency to that and probably reported it in.
I know. It's the craziest thing. It's the craziest.
Well, to be fair, we don't know that it's not your janky computer also. I mean, there could be a correlation there.
Could be.
Yeah, Text Expander is great. I mean, they, you know, talk about lock-in. Like, they were our first sponsor back in 2013. And, I mean, I still use it. I was probably already using it at that point. But, yeah, we're like, you know, that's pretty amazing. It maybe says something about the power of our podcast also, but certainly Text Expander, it's very sticky in the sense that, like, once you start using a system like that, you know, it becomes so habitual that when that bill comes up for renewal, it's, I mean, I'm using it all the time. So, I mean, you know, how can you question it? I imagine there's probably, well, I know there are other solutions. And in fact, you know, Apple has some built-in ones now that are like
close.
Just, yeah, close, like the very basic features of Text Expander. But I do some stuff, well, at least I used to, where with Text Expander, like I have forms that you can fill out and I deploy it for my whole team too, so that we're providing the same boilerplate text and standard recommendations and things. And back when the Apple affiliate program was a thing where I could just send a link to the Apple store online and have a client buy it directly, I mean, we were sending a ton of these recommendations, you know, very detailed with the exact specs that we recommend. The first form field was like, which Mac are you recommending? You know, select MacBook Pro 13, MacBook Pro 16, iMac, whatever. And it would like tailor the rest of the email to that specific recommendation. And that's a pretty advanced feature of Text Expander. And they do all kinds of stuff that you, forms and text based on the date. And even, I think there's even code you can run like within there that'll output something that then gets embedded in your little Text Expander snippet. So it's very powerful. And I'm a big fan of it still.
Yeah, it's pretty comprehensive. I do remember when they were sponsoring us, they would want us to talk about PDF Pen Pro. And we're like, can't we just talk about Text Expander? We love Text Expander. They're like, no, talk about PDF Pen Pro. That was pretty short-lived, the sponsorship.
And that might have been before the subscription model for Text Expander. And I think because the software is so sticky, as I put it, you know, once you sign up, they've got you on the hook for like whatever per month, you know, or per year, you're probably going to be a customer for many years. Whereas in the past, you know, you buy it once and then, you know, you may not pay anything for 5 years if you're like some of our clients, you know, where they just don't upgrade anything for sometimes that long. So I think that, you know, in this world, they might even do well to just promote that, the subscription to Text Expander, because once you get somebody on board, you know, the switching cost is kind of high, and most people, I think, are going to be longtime customers.
Yeah, and it's very easy for a client to understand the value of that. Once you show them something like that, it's really magical. I know that there's a lot of power users who use Keyboard Maestro. I have a subscription too, but I've never unpacked that too much. I do use Alfred for other extensible things that we can do with the keyboard and doing searches and populating fields and going to websites and things like that. And Alfred's great. I know that there's people who live and die and breathe Keyboard Maestro because that can also run scripts.
It's funny to hear you guys talk about Text Expander because I still use it. But Joe, you were just talking about people who hold on to old software forever. So I'm on Text Expander 5.1.6 prior to the subscription model on my Big Sur M1, and it still runs perfectly and does everything I need it to do. And so I have not gone and upgraded to the latest version that's subscription-based, and it works great for me.
Do you guys keep track of all your subscriptions on a spreadsheet, like what those are costing you on a yearly or monthly basis?
We have that in our accounting setup, but I don't have it on a spreadsheet, no.
David Sparks, who has been on the show a couple of years back, he actually has a free numbers spreadsheet pre-formatted that you can keep track of all your costs. It's pretty amazing. I think when I look at mine, I think my total yearly cost for not some of the bigger stuff that I use for my company, but just the small incidentals, it's like $3,000 a year. It can be really, can add up pretty quick.
That stuff adds up. I have two categories in my QuickBooks. You know, this is all, you know, for business related expenses for software. So I have software that's part of my operation of my business, like my support side of things. Team viewers in there, or maybe in the future, Splashtop. I'm trying to think of other examples. Well, Repair Shopper, you know, which is the platform I run the company on, things like that. So things that are specific to like rendering the support. And then I have a different category for like internal use software, things like QuickBooks itself, like regardless of what type of business I'm in, you know, I'm probably going to need accounting software. I kind of track it like that. I started doing that a couple years ago. So it's a suggestion in case anybody else, you know, is looking at doing this, you might categorize things like that are related to the services you offer versus just like running your business internally.
With that in mind, Joe, and you just mentioning that, it just reminded me of something. And I would imagine our listeners probably do this as well. Do you passively filter a lot of expenses that would normally be homeowner, the IRS is not listening, homeowner expenses through your company? As an example, the internet costs pretty much are picked up exclusively by MacWorks.
Yeah, for me, those things are gray areas. I don't put things in the company that are not company related, personally, just because I don't think there's real justification for that. I like the fact that I benefit personally from the expenses that are inherent to the business. You know, like you're describing, like, you know, the business needs really fast internet. I don't know that I would otherwise, like, get the fastest internet, you know, that I could get. But it's justification that, like, obviously I'm in a technology business, like, I need to have fast internet. So the company pays for it. And I personally also benefit. Same thing with my iPhone. You know, like, personally, I want the iPhone 12 Pro. Personally, if I weren't an Apple consultant, I'd probably be buying that outright if I want it bad enough, or just buying a cheaper one. But because the company pays for my phone, because obviously I'm in that business, you know, I can justify it a little bit more since it's a company expense, and therefore I'm getting the benefit of not paying the tax on that income, essentially. Like, you know, the business is making that money, and then the business is spending that money before it's taxed. So there's kind of a reduction in cost.
All right, riddle me this, Batman. What about a Netflix, monthly Netflix subscription?
And then depends on what you're watching. If you're doing research for the show, if you're watching Silicon Valley, then or you know, Halt and Catch Fire, or you know, I'm trying to think of off the top of my head, you know, something like what you know, those documentaries that are on there about the tech field. Gets into the gray area though, because technically, what I should do is there's some portion of that bill that is a business expense and some portion that's not. So are you supposed to divide it on that level?
Joe, you're as honest as the day is long. So how about you, Sam?
Asking questions.
We know that. Oh, I'm not getting drawn into this, Jerry. I think the way it works, Joe, if I'm not mistaken, though, is that you put it in as an expense and like a portion of that is written off as part of the business, if I recall correctly. So like internet, I do the same thing. I bumped up my internet speeds because I needed faster internet for the business, quote unquote. But I think the way my accountant does it is a portion of that expense is written off for tax purposes.
Right. What about chickens, like chicken feed? could you write that off?
I don't have a coop, but yeah, I write it off anyway.
Well, you know, anything you talk about on the show can be written off, right? Officially. So I wasn't audited. I think I'd had like review. There was some certain terminology for it, but like in my early days of my business, 2 or 3 years in, let's say, you know, I was operating out of my condo. I wrote off 40% of my condo. I wrote off my expense. And it was like electrical, you know, the cost of the electricity, cost of the mortgage, things like that. I had the IRS get in touch and want to review things. So an agent actually was scheduled to come to my condo, made the plan. They showed up and they took measurements. You know, she got out the tape measure and measured like the area. You know, I'm like, well, you know, here we are. I'm standing in my kitchen, you know, like directly behind me is my entire office, like closet. I have like equipment and inventory and whatever and blah, blah, blah. So she took all the measurements and she's like, yeah, actually, you're right. This is all good. It was zero adjustment in either direction. So I felt like that was very validating that, okay, I did the right thing there. At the time, I was writing off, I think, 40% of significant expenses, because that was how I was operating my business. Was like the entire living space was practically all business.
Yeah, but so, that's a very intense encounter with an IRS agent, that they came to your domicile and they took out the tape measure.
Yeah.
Wow.
It felt pretty invasive, but I was just like, well, let's just see what happens. This will be an interesting test here, you know?
And, it's about as close to the metal as you can get.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, that, you know, and I'm glad I was doing things like apparently pretty much by the book, but I could see how that could also be.
I have no doubt. Because, right, Sam? You know,
imagine if they went to Jerry's house. Yeah. This chicken coop serves as his office.
Yeah. It says here you have 4 employees and it's like the Latin word for a chicken. I don't know.
Did I tell you we got to name our chickens? So there's 4 people in our family. I think my wife named hers Chicory. And they came around to me because we got them as fledglings. I think that's what you call a little chicken, a fledgling. I don't know. I named mine Flouncy. You don't necessarily have to comment, but just wanted to share with you that that's my chicken's name is Flouncy.
You don't have to comment.
Well, I will comment. But you know what I found odd? I actually spoke with someone the other day who also has a chicken coop. And he said they also named their chickens, but they named them after different chicken meals, which I thought was very strange.
I like that too.
Like, this is Parm. This is, you know,
Chicken a la King.
Yeah, it was really weird.
It's like the weatherman named Storm. You know, it's like, this is your destiny. You're destined to become a chicken parmesan or something.
I hesitate to say he was born Storm, but we'll go with that.
So as long as we're keeping with the Jerry show today here, I have another Jerry topic. This is a quick one. I don't think you ever mentioned this in the show, Jerry, but you brought this up to me and I've been using it. Sam, have you used this? It's fast.com?
No.
It's basically a speed test made by Netflix. First of all, it's web-based, so it actually just works in Safari. And it's very, very fast to actually run the test. You know, there's no ads popping up everywhere like with speedtest.net. Jerry, you brought this up because you were seeing better, like more accurate results from fast.com?
There's some sort of stipulation, depending on where you go for speed tests, what kind of packets they send back and forth. And sometimes you can get an erroneous reading, significantly lower reading than what your ISP is promising you, because the ISP is actually filtering those packets that are transferring back and forth. I'm sure there's a much more detailed technical explanation than that, but that's essentially it, that you can't necessarily base your ISP results completely on going to like speedtest.net. You have to go to a couple.
Yeah, it's nice to have that alternative just to test out. Just a nice tip to listeners, fast.com. So I have another tip, setting up a ProtonMail account. Have you guys used ProtonMail?
I have, yes.
Yep.
Secure email, as they put it, which, you know, used to be...
Oxymoron?
Yeah, an oxymoron, right. And it's maybe geared toward the tinfoil hat crowd a little bit because, you know, everybody's afraid of like their email not being secure. Rightly so. It's not secure. But then this is this kind of thing where it's like, well, this is a panacea. You're just like, just use this and then it'll be secure. You know, and of course, the reality is a little bit more subtle. But I've looked into it. I did a little bit of a dive on it a couple years ago. And it does offer more protection. I mean, certainly it's encrypted in the sense that, well, most email these days is encrypted going point to point. So if you use SSL on your connection, you know, your email leaving your computer and then arriving on the remote mail server, that part's encrypted. And of course, they, you know, with ProtonMail, they ensure the same thing, but they go a little bit farther. So they also encrypt the emails on the server. So that
at, you know, rest, Joe,
at rest. Thank you.
In the technical world, we call that at rest.
At rest. So they encrypt the emails at rest as well. And so there's, you know, there's an encryption key that protects the emails. So then you might be thinking like, well, you know, how does that actually work in practice? I mean, we all have mail clients. You know, how does my email client go and fetch an email that's encrypted at the remote server? The way they do this on the Mac, you can actually add the account to Mail App or Outlook. And they actually run this thing called the ProtonMail Bridge on the local device on my Mac. It's like a proxy, I guess. It sets up a proxy connection to the remote server to handle the actual encryption. And Mail App is just talking to the local, essentially the local mail server that ProtonMail Bridge is running. Of course, you can just do this through webmail because then it's just easy because they control the webmail app, so to speak. Or on your iPhone, you would use the ProtonMail app. So I was setting this up for the first time with a, you know, custom domain so they can host your email, or you can get a free ProtonMail email address. And as part of their setup for the custom domain, when you go through the SPF and DKIM, you know, and then DMARC, when you're setting those things up, you know, you have to be really careful and get it right. And also, you don't want your mail to have deliverability issues in general, like where just email's not functioning. But you also don't want it to set up incorrectly so that your mail is being flagged as spam to a high degree. So how do you know that? I mean, yeah, you can test sending to a Gmail user, sending to a iCloud user, and just make sure that, you know, they deliver properly. But they refer to this site called mailtester.com. So it's mail-tester.com. So you just go to mail-tester.com. They give you a custom email address that you send your email to. So they generate that on the fly, and it's just for your session here, you know, testing your email. And you simply send them an email to that address, and then you check the score. You check, you know, how you did. So this is not only for potentially server connection issues, but it could also be for mail content, because, you know, your mail may be flagged not due to configuration issues, but due to like content in the message, you know, spammy content, or you know, if you're sending a newsletter and, you know, you might want to like copy and paste the text or just send the newsletter to this particular site, you know, to this email address that they give you to see if it fails based on content. But I just thought it was an interesting thing if a client is having issues or you're doing a mail migration for somebody and you want to just test it on the other side and make sure things work. Yeah, mailtester.com. it's kind of like the story Jerry told earlier of like converting data using an online service, you know, testing your email using an online service. These online services make those things really easy sometimes. You know, you don't have to buy an app. You don't have to like set something up and configure something. It's just sitting there on a website that you can access from anywhere. I mean, it couldn't be easier. But of course, you know, you're sending that data to someone else. I mean, you know, where this gets really kind of tricky is back in the day, one of the easiest ways to convert vCard to CSV, for example, or things like that, you know, were some of these online services. They're really easy to use. They work great. But, you know, you're sending like your client's contact list to some unknown person at the other end.
Right.
Probably not a good idea. So I was always hesitant to ever use one of those. And I certainly would never put, you know, my data or my client's data through it. Those services are out there. You have to just be careful and maybe look into like who's running this thing.
Well, that's what I've always felt about that website. Have I been pwned, you know, or check my password? Maybe they're legitimate. Maybe the guy who runs that or the gal, they're fine, but no thanks. You know, I'll take my chances. You know, I'm not going to have you test my password. I'm not going to tell you my email address so you can tell me that I was hacked. No, thank you.
Yeah, right. Just give us your 10 most commonly used passwords and we'll tell you if they're secure.
If they're good, yeah.
It's like a Schrodinger's cat problem. It's like as soon as you check the email, the password to see if it's secure, it's not secure because now you've just given it to some website, you know. There's definitely a lot of merit in that kind of service, you know, that have I been pwned or similar services to like monitor the dark web to see if like your email pops up with a supposed password in the list. I wouldn't give them any more data than like your email, you know. Right. There's too many examples throughout history of companies kind of double dipping, you know, where it's like they're running this service in a very altruistic way. Like, we'll tell you if there's a problem. It's like a very perverse incentive because they benefit when there are more problems. Right. So justifies their existence. And so maybe somebody at the company says, I know how we can boost the metrics this quarter, you know.
It's like, yeah, that was a big thing with antivirus companies years ago, too. It was just like, I don't know, how do you trust these guys? They're probably making the viruses so that they can pretend like they're protecting you. That was a big thing that I heard from people for a while. So there's always going to be that theory.
Circling back to Proton Mail, they have a free version. It's the same as the paid version. Paid version gives you more storage, a few more features. But, you know, if you do need to create a secure email address, it's still one of the most reliable options to be safe. I had to set up an account for my dad for an Australian service using a VPN. And so I used Proton Mail to set up the account that would establish him as a user on this Australian website.
I bet you charged him for the work.
Command Control Power is a labor of love sustained by the generous support of our community. Since 2013, we've produced over 400 weekly episodes. This episode is brought to you for free thanks to the support of our community on Patreon. To join them in making a monthly pledge, please visit commandcontrolpower.com and click on support. Ryan Gowdy, corecompetent.com. Cirrus Partners, gocirrus.com. Weldon Dodd, rewindtech.com. Envision Design, envisiondesign.net. Adam Rice, askadam.io. Tim Nyberg, themacguys.com. Mac Admins Podcast, podcast.macadmins.org. Michael Thompson, origin84.com. Jerome Potters,
PIT Pro.
Matthew Waples, waples.net. Andy Espo, callandy.com. Tom Poles, boxit.tech. Nate Sinal, wearescout.com. And Steve Sorbo, macsos.biz. Thank you all for listening and for your support of Command Control Power.
Jerry does his voices of customers of all kinds.
Am I on the cloud?
Joe Spin.